My name is Ritika Patni. I'm the founder of The Art of Health in Singapore, and I'm delighted again to welcome you today for another episode of the World Ayurveda podcast series, where we've been bringing you fascinating conversations from the world of Ayurveda, speaking to entrepreneurs, doctors, researchers, and Ayurveda enthusiasts from different parts of the globe. I'm very happy today to introduce my guest, who I think it's difficult to really define in just a few words because of her really illustrious career and achievements. Some would know her as a powerful businesswoman, and for some others, she's an avid art collector. But what really brings her amidst us today is her passion for Ayurveda, for having created one of India's foremost Ayurvedic beauty brands, Kama Ayurveda. I'm delighted to welcome Ms. Rajshree Pathi. Namaste, Rajshree.
Namaste, Ritika. I'm delighted to be on this. Ayurveda, as you know, is very close to my heart. And, you know, I grew up in Coimbatore, surrounded with one of the world's most, the oldest Ayurvedic treatment center, actually, which is the Ayurvedic pharmacy, AVP. And I remember even when I was like 8 years old, you know, my mother taking me to see Sri P.S. Rama Warrior those years, and sitting on, you know, he used to be meeting us in sitting in a tiny little room with just a dhoti and, you know, all kinds of portions on the table. And he would do the Nadi. And, you know, Nadi is the diagnostics for Ayurveda. And he would say, okay, you got a chest cold, and he'd shake up something in a few minutes and we'd drink it. Of course, when we were younger and, you know, we used to detest that taste of all those kashayams, all those portions. But we lived on it. We breathed Ayurveda. And every Sunday was the day when we would put Neeli Bringadi on our hair and then wait for an hour and then have a full body massage with all the Ayurvedic oils and then have hot water which has been boiled for hours with firewood and all the herbs and all the leaves and everything and wash off. And so Sunday was a weekly ritual. And when our babies were born, you know, for 3 months we would get somebody from the Ayurvedic center to massage and get us all back into shape, and also massage the little babies, the newborn babies. They would put them on their feet and then massage their legs to increase blood circulation. So for me, I mean, I grew up with Ayurveda. It's an integral part of my childhood. So we've lived, breathed, used Ayurveda ever since we were children.
That is such a fascinating description of using Ayurveda in your day-to-day life. So no wonder that you were inspired to then create Kama, you know, as you grew up. But Rajshree, you of course have had the heritage of Ayurveda all around you growing up in Coimbatore. How do you now ensure in today's kind of, you know, more modern times with people traveling all over the globe, how do you ensure that this rich heritage of Ayurvedic rituals and knowledge is transferred to your children and they continue to use it?
You know, this is a good question. And the reason I started Kama and the idea of Kama was born because I felt that, you know, my own cousins, even in my generation, or my children, when I had the children growing up, they were getting far away from Ayurveda. They were all getting into, you know, all these FMCG kind of, you know, shampoos and body lotions and everything, because Ayurveda and Ayurvedic treatments were very cumbersome. You know, they were either smelly or too oily, and you know, they were not well packaged. You couldn't carry them with you. So I felt that, you know, as a user and a beneficiary of Ayurvedic treatments, that how can I make it more accessible to the next generation? How can I do something in this vast pool of legacy that we have in this country? How can I make a difference? So that's how the idea of karma was born. And we focused on precisely this. What does the modern day user require? What is the demand of this modern day society? And what is the requirement for a modern day lifestyle when everyone is traveling, when people are living in smaller homes, people are living in apartments, people are, you know, having to share bathroom spaces. You can't have your whole house smelling of, Bringadi oil, or you can't go out smelling, you know, and so on. And also you can't have, you know, you need to have packaging. And so the first thought was, how do we make Ayurveda a product of Ayurveda without removing the efficacy, making it as authentic as the true product, and making a packaging, developing a packaging that would be appealing, at the same time retain the efficacy, because you can't put everything, all Ayurvedic oils in transparent bottles and so on. If you can see, this is our Bringadi, and the Bringadi is in this brown color bottle. And this is because this oil and the herb in this oil is being distilled for months before it comes into this package. And this has to be, the shelf life has to last for about a year. It has to be retained in this kind of a bottle, in this color of a bottle. So, you know, and how do we brand it? So, you know, someone like you, for instance, you're much younger, you're the next generation. And why would you want to buy this product? So we thought a lot about how do we keep the legacy? The legacy is kept in the branding, the designing, you know, even the copper goldish kind of cover, which was patented by us because it didn't exist, this color, and to create this sense of luxury. And also, if you can see, this is the AVP symbol. You know, this is the where karma stands apart from every other Ayurvedic product in the world, is because we are partners with one of the oldest Ayurvedic manufacturers in the world. So all of this is what makes Karma the brand.
Wow. That's almost like this short masterclass in Ayurvedic entrepreneurship with all of those ideas. But what was the genesis of this idea, Rajshri? You know, I'm sure you were inspired through a series of events growing up in your life. But what was that one moment which led you to really create Karma? And then I'd also really like to know that, how did the name Karma really come about?
Okay, I mean, you were asking me for my Eureka moment. You know, we were celebrating a birthday in Coimbatore, one of my special birthdays, and I had three friends visit me from Delhi. And I think every one of them was looking to do something different from what they were doing. And we are very good friends. And I was discussing this with them, and I said, look, why don't I have this idea? And I can put the collaboration with AVP together. Can we all do this together? One of them, who currently manages the Karma business, Vivek Sani, who is a very well-reputed graphic designer with a great sense of aesthetics. The other partner, Vikram Goel, he came in from New York. He was working with Morgan Stanley. So he had the whole, you know, international flavor about him, in the internationality of finances and so on. And then another partner was Dave Chang, who had a great sense of smell and also aesthetics and so on. So, and I had the whole Ayurvedic background. At that point, none of these Delhi friends had any idea of Ayurveda or knew about Ayurvedic treatments, but we all came in with collective strengths, and we put our heads down and said, okay, let's create a brand that is a world-class brand. So we never ever compromised on authenticity, on the product, on the packaging, on anything. And you know Karma. So that was a Eureka moment. It was coming together of several collective strengths, and all of us remain very good friends and partners in this business. I couldn't take on a full-on responsibility because I had other business responsibilities. But that was the Eureka moment. Great. What was the other question? I think you asked me another question. I lost it.
I wanted to know where the name really came about, you know.
Okay. So again, we thought of many names, but we said, you know, what do we want the user to feel? Because Karma has to be an experiential product. Karma has to give the user an experience. So what is it that we can portray in the product and in the packaging and in the branding? So we said Karma has to be a luxury product, first of all. We have to take Ayurveda out of the connotation and the popular understanding that it's just, you know, a very sort of it's an oily, smelly product, and we needed therefore to make it a luxury product. And it never existed until Karma happened. The world did not have a Ayurvedic luxury product. So we came up with, so we asked ourselves, what would be the right sentiment or emotion when somebody wants to buy a Karma product? And we said desire. We want everyone to desire our product. We want everyone to look at it on the shelf and say, I want it. So we decided on Karma. Easy, globally acceptable, and simple, and yet has this wonderful connotations that everything Karma stands for. Love, desire, luxury, opulence, old world, ancient, traditional, culture, all of it. And something that could resonate in everybody's minds anywhere in the world, you know?
Yes. That's wonderful. That also, I think it really embodies your passion for the brand and the products. Today, Rajshree, if you see, the world is really moving to clean and natural beauty trends. You see that all around you globally, you know. Sustainability really is the theme for this decade, and people are realizing the importance of using clean products. This, of course, has always been true to the essence of Ayurvedic beauty rituals, which were always, you know, about clean and natural beauty. So what opportunities do you see today for Ayurveda beauty brands in the world?
I see that it's going to be an enormous growth. I think more and more people are open now to integrating Ayush practices or Ayurvedic practices into their rituals. And I think the awareness has grown. I mean, if you ask me about, you know, what has been one of the positive things that have come out of COVID, I think people have had the time to ask themselves, you know, what is good for me? What is good for me? And they've had the time, because they don't have to get onto flights or, you know, be running around. They've had time to really ask themselves, what is good for my body? What is good for my mind? I mean, please understand, Ayurveda is a holistic philosophy of you know, healing. It has many components. It's just not what you put on your face or what you just drink in. Ayurveda is a system of nurturing yourself. It's a system of healing, a system of creating well-being, and largely it's preventive treatments. Allopathy is not preventive. There's a big difference in it. And therefore, when you ask me what is the future, I mean, I can only envision a much larger percentage of users of natural products, and Ayurveda being a large component of it. Because you can't take away 5,000 years of data, of data-based scientific way of curing. And people are also looking into the mind-body balance, you know, for themselves. People are getting away from sleeping pills. People are thinking about meditation. People are meditating. There are technologically advanced tools for meditation that incorporate, you know, meditative sounds from our ancient texts, mantras, and so on. And you know, so it's holistic. And so then they ask themselves, what can I put on my face, or what can I eat that is all, you know, all already there. And it's called Ayurveda. So the Ayurveda now, thanks to cross-cultural interactions, a more open society, which is not judgmental, and also the openness to accept, you know, alternate ways of healing.
Absolutely. So, you know, you were one of the first persons, like you said, Kama was one of the first brands to really put Ayurveda out there in front of consumers in a manner that was aspirational. And we've come a long way since then. What is your message today for aspiring entrepreneurs who are looking at Ayurveda as, you know, a sector that they want to work in?
Okay, so I get many, many inquiries on LinkedIn, on Facebook, saying that, you know, we want to talk to you, or we want to know, can you be our mentor, and so on. The first thing I say is, do you know what Ayurveda stands for? Whatever you produce has to be true to the philosophy of Ayurveda if you want to be successful. The reason Kama is successful globally is because we've been authentic. We have kept the promise of Ayurveda in every drop, in every lotion, in every drop, in every bottle that we produce. We need responsible entrepreneurs. We need responsible manufacturers with good manufacturing processes. And I think staying true to the philosophy, taking time to understand it, and reading something about it, experiencing it before, you know, you just decide to take something and put it in a bottle and call it Ayurveda, doesn't make you successful as an entrepreneur. So that is my only message. Every entrepreneur, please, the more the better, but we want to put out what is really the true philosophy of Ayurveda in everything we make.
Wonderful. Like I said, sustainability is the theme for the decade. So I think responsible entrepreneurship goes very well with that. And, you know, how do you really use business as a force for good, as they say? So, Rachi, one of the things that you mentioned in the beginning was your association with AVP, or Ayurvedic Pharmacy, which is one of India's oldest Ayurvedic institutions. And that was, of course, you know, led by Dr. Krishna Kumarji for so many years. For those of us who are closely involved in the Ayurveda world know that unfortunately he passed away just you know, a few weeks back. And since you worked closely with him, how would you remember his legacy?
You know, for me, he was a spiritual brother, a guide, and someone I would always go to for any kind of physical issue that I had or my family had. He would be the first person I'd pick up. If I had any problem, you know, I would go to him for his advice. Now, that was a very personal relationship that I have with him. And, you know, I continue to have it with several members of the family who have taken on the legacy after his passing away. It was deeply emotional for me, you know, to have him gone. Anyway, so what he's done is phenomenal. First of all, right as early as 1977, he implemented a 7.5-year curriculum for Ayurvedic studies and affiliated it first to the University of Madras and then later to the Bharatiya University. And this course introduced Ayurvedic studies along with components of spiritual practices. Because Ayurveda, spiritual practices, yoga, and teachings all really embody this whole science of healing. And he was worked very closely with the Government of India and its department, you know, and science, and the Department of Science and Technology, the Department of Environment, all of that. Wherever he could, he introduced the importance and the relevance of Ayurveda in their research. I could talk to you for an hour about it, but nevertheless, you know, he believed though that whatever his institution did had to be backed up with verifiable scientific data that's collected from the clinic and from the patients they treated for every disease, including cancer. I have personally met patients who's, you know, who have been declared, dead literally with cancer, you know, people who have had organs removed. And I've met these people and they've come with x-rays and with allopathic, senior institutions saying that they have 6 months to live. And I have watched their progress over years and how they've emerged as, you know, cancer free. And I mean, I can tell you on as a first person who's not here, say, because I go to AVP every year. So over several years, I've met the same people coming and, you know, had conversations with him. So one of his main contributions, I must say, is that he has now made it global. He's taken Ayurveda global, and one must give him singular credit for tying up with countries like Brazil, Argentina, Chile, Latvia, Switzerland, and UK, and the US, Singapore, Malaysia, all these countries, and integrated Ayurveda into their clinical research studies. And documentation, as we speak, is continuing to happen. So this is what he did, not being just a practitioner or running a manufacturing unit or a clinic or an education center, he actually documented cures and therapies for the world to understand Ayurveda much better and not question its use or question its sustainability.
Thank you, Rajshree, for that. I think one of the things that we realize, with Krishna Kumarji's passing away is also the huge shoes he's left, which need to be filled in terms of the work that has to be done for Ayurveda as we move ahead into this coming decade. So with your background, of having seen Ayurveda over the years, what, according to you, is the future of Ayurveda? How would you envision the future of Ayurveda over this coming decade in 2030?
Ritika, I think we are on a very good situation in India now, because the Modi government actually plans to roll out a one nation, one health system policy by 2030, which would integrate modern and traditional systems of medicine like allopathy, homeopathy, Ayurveda in medical practice, education and research. So the government is committed to it. The Modi government is committed to this, and I think that is a first step towards integrating pluralistic methods of treatments, and I think that is a great big crossover. You know, there are challenges, of course, because every system of medicine wants to protect itself. They put in barriers of entry, they put in systems of control. There are legal issues, regulations, export conditions to export certain herbs and so on. Even in Karma, we face all these things all the time. Certain countries want very many certificates, and every ingredient that goes into an Ayurvedic oil needs to be, identified and permissions to be granted. And even in some places, we still can't sell some of the products. But with India actually making it and forming a framework for this integration, I think is a great step forward. Now, for instance, if a patient comes to a hospital, they can be given allopathic treatment if their condition is serious. But now, I mean, why can't they also be given homeopathic or Ayurvedic treatment in the same hospital if their doctor is knowledgeable about these systems and says, okay, let's try this first before we move on to something more harsher? Of course, as I said, allopathy has, you have a lot of investment into research for allopathic medicines. The companies have invested hugely. There are stakeholders. So it's not an easy path, but I think the path is set. And I think we're crossing one barrier. It's important that governments have formally included it and recognized Ayurveda in many countries as a treatment. That is the first step. So with that, I think it's great. And with the One Nation, One Health System policy, there are four working groups which are made now to discuss education, research, clinical practice, public health, and administration, and how Ayurveda is integrated into all these things. Education is very important. Without education and spreading it around everywhere, Ayurvedic education, you cannot have good vaidyans, good doctors. They have to be global. And I myself have met so many good vaidyans, Ayurvedic vaidyans, coming in from various parts of the world with Krishna Kumarji. So it's happening, and it's happening for the good. It's happening for the good of humanity.
Absolutely. That's thank you for sharing that vision, Rajshree. Of course, the government is doing some great work, and there are also other examples in the form of other systems of traditional medicine which have been integrated into modern mm-hmm. medicine practices in other countries where we can learn from and try and also implement those lessons in India and around the world to ensure that Ayurveda becomes a part of an integrative model of healthcare. Mm-hmm. We'll conclude, Rajshree, with a few really quick questions. You can give me answers in a few words. So how would you describe the following in one word? Ayurveda. Okay.
Well-being.
Kama.
Desire.
Beauty.
Soul.
So what is the one Ayurveda beauty practice that you think absolutely everybody should follow?
I think everybody should take 3 weeks off to go and do a therapy and full Ayurvedic body cleansing therapy at any good Ayurvedic center, which includes Abhyangam, your Navarakili, your Nasyam, Sirovati, Pilichal, depending on the recommendation of the Ayurvedic physician who is taking care of them. And I think the medicated oils penetrating your body, rejuvenating every cell in your body, removing the toxins. I think every one of us can take those 3 weeks out, and we have to do it for ourselves. This is one Ayurvedic practice. Do it anywhere. I mean, India has so many authentic centers, at different levels, different locations. Even abroad, Europe is offering Ayurvedic treatments. The East is offering Ayurvedic treatments. I mean, Thailand has Ayurveda. They also follow Ayurveda, So I think it's very important. That's one practice that increases longevity, mental health, and organ rejuvenation.
Fantastic. What is the one Ayurveda beauty ritual, something special that you have passed on to your kids?
I swear on the Bringadi oil. I haven't lost hair, and I use the Bringadi oil every week. And to me, this is something that even my son, who he's a guy, and he uses this every Sunday, and he's seen that hair loss is far less and stop. And there are studies, by the way, and you can Google it. There's a study that minoxidil and Bringadi has been used for testing patients with hair loss, and it's one of the major institutions in the US, and I cannot recall which one, but one of the leading institutions. And it's on the net that they found that people using Bringadi, the hair loss was stopped far quicker than using minoxidil.
Fantastic. Yes, for our listeners, minoxidil is the commonly used treatment which is prescribed for preventing and arresting hair loss. So that's a really good tip out there for anyone looking for simple, easy, clean Ayurveda based solutions. And my final question to you, Rajshri, is what is your favorite Tama product? We may already know the answer, but
okay. No, I might surprise you. It's my Kumkumadi face scrub.
Okay,
it's the Kumkumadi face scrub that I use twice a day, and I've been using it since we manufactured it. This comes a natural scrub, and as you can see, it is mixed with the Kumkumadi oil for skin brightening and for tightening skin. The skin, and as you get older, it just is an amazing, amazing product. You can just take a little bit, and it's a good face scrub. As you can see, it has granules, and you just put it on and massage it, and in a few seconds, wash it off with warm water, and you just see all your black spots, your darkening, all of this disappears. This is an amazing product, something I've used for years now, and twice a day to wash my face.
Fantastic. I hope there are a lot of users who are now going to visit the website and, in today's times of e-commerce, order some of these beautiful products that you have recommended and that you swear by. Thank you once again, Rajshri. That was a really interesting, fascinating conversation. We are very, very grateful for your time. Thank you once again. Namaste.
Thank you so much. It's been such a pleasure. And thanks for spreading the word of Ayurveda all over the world. Thank you so much.